name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This may be something of a rhetorical question, but has the United States always been governed by the Constitution? Well, no. Now, that may or may not come as a surprise to you. From the end of the Revolutionary War, for about 10 years, the United States was governed by something that we call the Articles of Confederation. The new United States quickly found out, however, that the Articles of Confederation were not working. You see, the United States were anything but united. In that era of the Articles of Confederation, the states were the ones that reigned supreme. State laws superseded any laws held in common. So, in effect, the United States were a collection of many states or small nations. So, the Constitutional Convention was called for, agreement hammered out, and we began living under the U.S. Constitution in the year 1789. But very quickly, we recognized that the Constitution was not specific enough in certain areas. The anti-federalists were wary of too much central authority.
That's kind of
familiar to this day, doesn't it? Then it was negotiated. What was negotiated was the Bill of Rights, the first 10 amendments to the United States Constitution. Those first 10 amendments guaranteed certain personal freedoms and limited the power of the federal government. In the intervening 226 years, since the Constitution, only 17 other amendments have been added. Well, you have to know that Amendment 21 repealed Amendment 18, and those two had to do with repeal of prohibition. So that really means in 226 years, there have been only 15 amendments to the U.S. Constitution. Because amending the Constitution is lengthy and rigorous. By contrast, Moses was given the Ten Commandments somewhere between 3,500 and 3,300 years ago. And the Ten Commandments were the beginning of the law, with that capital L in Jewish tradition. Now, between Moses and the time of Jesus, the law had grown from the original 10 to 613 precepts. 613. 27 amendments versus 613 laws of Moses, as they were called. Can you name all of the 27 amendments to the U.S. Constitution? Well, neither can I. Can any intelligent, articulate Jewish person in the world of Jesus name all 613 of the law? Yet all those 613 articles of the law were held to be equally binding among the Jewish people. Things that must be done by the community just to gather to worship. And as you heard in the gospel story, even the proper way of to wash pots and pans in preparation of food were included among those 613 laws. And even if one were skipped, the whole process became invalid. Which is exactly the problem Jesus has with the Pharisees. They're not thinking why washing pots and pans is so unimportant to God in the big picture. First of all, you have to keep in mind that the Pharisees are sincerely religious in the Jewish faith that they share with Jesus. They're not bad people. The name Pharisee comes from a Hebrew word meaning separated one. You see, the Pharisee movement was in direct reaction to the secular culture of the day. They were trying to distance themselves from the prevailing culture by keeping all of those 613 precepts of the law. So, Jesus would say to the Pharisees, yes, your attempt to be close to God is good, but your practice, it's your practice, my friend, that actually put barriers that keep the common person from honoring God. Now, of course, I know we may be getting to this in kind of a roundabout way this morning, but a little background is kind of insightful in understanding the heart and the mind of Jesus, and the heart of Jesus for the common person, or for the ordinary person. Because the common person, the ordinary person, is always so dear to the heart of God. Hand washing here, in this story that you've heard, has nothing to do with hygiene. It's all about ritual purity. The way in one which washes one's hands, even pots and pans, to the Pharisees, that reflects the way that God is honored in life. Except, the Pharisees had fallen in love with ritual rather than falling in love with God. So, we've taken some time to go over these customs because this is what Jesus is up to. The minutiae of observing the supposed law of God. The Pharisees, these rules were the very essence of religion. To observe them was to please God. To ignore them, to break them, was a sin. This is their idea of goodness and service to God. So, in a religious sense, Jesus and the ones he contend with are really speaking almost a different language. The common person, Jesus knows this, the common person doesn't have the means to honor God as the Pharisees do. Jesus would say that there is no amount of external washing or ritual that can cleanse your attitude of hate or bigotry or malice or contempt or condemnation. In essence, Jesus is saying to those who listen to him, he's asking us today by extension, where is your heart? Where is your heart? Where is your center? Because for people of faith, and in the long biblical tradition, it's the heart. It's the heart that is the center of people's, of a person's life and emotion. And that's where the struggle between good and evil takes place. It's in your heart. Because what's in your heart ultimately shows forth what comes out in your life. Where is your center? And what is in your heart at the very center, at the very core of your being? You heard this, that Jesus is not necessarily concerned with long-standing tradition, particularly if that tradition erects barriers to God. Jesus struggles those who pay particular attention to the tradition of the day rather than wanting to come. Because, Jesus is pointing out, their hearts seem to be dark, or rather, far from God. Now, if your center and if your heart is if that which is in your heart, then that which is good and godly can come forth from your center. By come forth, I mean your heart for God. It shows inward and in your deed, because it comes from your center and it comes from your heart. Jesus might be saying to the Pharisees, really to all of us, stop thinking, your God may be too small. What you're trying to do is limit God, or rather, consider this, that God may be so much bigger than you can imagine. That's why Jesus has no trouble ignoring law and commandments. The most important thing that you can do that comes from your heart, that comes from your center, is to love God, to love your neighbor, and to love yourself. God is just too big to tolerate anything else. Here's a story. The disciples were full of questions about God. So, said the Master, God is the unknown, and God is the unknowable. Every statement about God, every answer is a distortion of the truth of God. The disciples were bewildered. Then why do you speak about God at all? Why do you speak about God at all? So the Master responded. Why does the bird sing? the bird sings not because it has a statement to say. The bird sings because it has a song in its body. Listen to God with your spirit. Listen to God with your heart. Be with God in your heart. Because in the heart of God, there is